I know. is happy to be in the Lord's house this morning. You guys ready to worship the one true God this morning? Yeah? Amen. Praise you, Lord.
Above all names.
just encourage you to take a moment to allow all the events of this past week to just melt away, and all the events that we're looking toward happening, let that schedule just kind of slip away for a moment. And here in this place, just say, Lord, find me. I am here, God.
Now I can find
Presence of the conqueror. Lord, to know that whatever I've got going on in my life, Lord, it's not bigger than you. I can allow it to become bigger than I think you are. But Lord, that's not reality. God, open our eyes to the reality of who you are. Lord, you're not just an idea. You're not just a religion. You're not just a way for people to gather. Lord, you are the true, the real, the living God. And because of you, Lord, I have victory. God, teach me what it is to lean on you. Lord, to gather my strength that I don't have from you. God, teach me to press in and rely more, God, when I just can't see. Because, Lord, you are holy and you are awesome. In your name, everyone said, amen, amen, amen. Why don't you guys go ahead and have a seat.
Well, good morning. Good morning, everybody. I want to take a second to say happy Mother's Day. And all of our mothers that are here, if we could, can we just show them appreciation for being here today? Amen. I want to extend that to those moms that are watching from home today. Man, happy Mother's Day to you. And also to a very special mom watching from home today. Happy Mother's Day, Shirley Wiseman. That's my mama. I'm the lead pastor here at the church, so I can do that. So. But you know, my mother watches every week. Yes, she does. Even though she's a pastor's wife and she's got kids and grandkids all over the country doing services and stuff. But she does. She watches every week and she'll call and, baby, that was real nice. Or she'll call and say, now, I don't know if I'd said that, you know, stuff like that. But it's just good. It's good to have moms here today. And we do also want to welcome our guest. If you're a first-time guest, can we show our appreciation to those that are here? Yeah. Good having y'all today. As you leave this service today, if you're a guest, what we want you to do is go down the halls, and at that back, that bigger lobby, you'll see a couple high-top tables. We just want to be able to give you a gift for being here today, so if you would do that. If you're a guest here or a guest at home, if you go to www.mymomentumchurch.tv, you'll be able to see on there a digital connection card. Just let us know that you came today, or if you're watching online for the first time, we will send you a gift at home in the mail, but also if you're here, you can go at the end of the hall and pick up a gift from us today. All right. I do have one announcement. Next Sunday, we are going to be doing a car wash here at the church for our young adults, for our youth ministry. And so it's to help offset some of their camp expenses. And so what we'll be doing is if you want your car washed during service next week, as you pull up on property, there'll be people there directing you where to go in the front lot to leave your car. And it's just a donation, whatever you want to give. But from that point forward, they'll take care of the rest while you're in service. Now, I promise you, there'll be no teenagers driving your cars. Now, I can't say that Pastor Tyler will be that much better. He's not here to defend himself. But there will be no teenagers driving. But just if you want to help the young people out, that's what you can do next week, all right? And so I think that's it. I do have a neat announcement. Today we have a very special guest speaker, the love of my life, all right? Married 27 years to this woman, mama of 5 children, and a wonderful communicator of the Word of God, both in our home and here at the church. And so if you would, I don't normally do this for a guest speaker. She's not a guest. She's part of this staff. But if you would, stand to your feet and welcome my wife, Pastor Amy Wiseman, to the stage.
Aw, thank you, guys. I appreciate it. It's so sad. He has to set up anything technical for me. I mean, it's an iPad, for goodness sakes.
Anything else that you need?
Actually, over there are some gifts. Just bring them on over here. Please and thank you. So it is an honor, again, to be able to speak. Thank you. I think I'll keep them. It is an honor to be up here today, and I would like to start off with it being Mother's Day. I would like to give three wonderful ladies a gift, and it doesn't necessarily have to be a mom, but I just want to honor ladies today. So could I have over here, let's see, Anna, come on up here. Yeah, Anna. Just stand up here and hold this. Thank you, yes. And then let's see, who do we have? Lita, can you come up here? Lita, actually have. I did handpick that. You go over there. And then, do I have Alicia Palmer here today? Alicia, she has 9 kids. It's a lot to get to church. I get it. All right. Well, I am going to. Joyce, yes, Joy, get up here. Yes, Joy, absolutely. You can kill me later. You can. Here you go. I want you ladies to open these gifts. The reason I was looking for Alicia Palmer, there is a funny story with that, but it's a gift for everybody, but it's only she would get it. So anyway, what'd you guys get? What'd you get, Anna? What is this? It's for creamer. Yes, it's for coffee. Yes. Creamer. What do we have, Joy? A French press. Yep, yep. And Lita, what is this? A pitcher. These all three have a different reason for pouring. Do you agree? Every one of these do. But they have something in common. What do all three of these have in common? They pour. Absolutely. Thank you, ladies. You can take those home with you. I was really hoping the one that got the coffee would actually drink coffee, so I think you can do it with tea as well. So anyway, we are a lot like that. As believers, we are containers of things. And even though what we pour might be different, we all have a purpose in pouring. And so I have something kind of cute just to throw back. My son Maverick made this. And yes, isn't it cute? I should have 5 of these. But because I throw everything away, I only have one. So I don't know where the other ones are. My kids make fun of me because I seem to throw things away quite often, which I don't want to hear anything from the front row. But this one's from Maverick, and honestly, it's a container, but I'm thinking you probably could pour out of it because there's a really big crack in this, and I'm sure this stuff could come out. So, but again, this was lovingly crafted and had a purpose. And so I wanted to bring that because I just thought that was so cute. But just another throwback I want to share with you is a quote that I had written about, I don't know, 3 or 4 months ago. I can't remember why I wrote it, but I can remember why I wrote it, but I can't remember exactly what was going on when I did write it, but I can remember the season and the place I was living when I did write it. And so I don't know if you guys journal or not, but I love to journal because for me, I can overthink or things can live in my head for a long time. And if I don't get it down on paper, it's like I can't disengage from it. And sometimes I like to journal because there's things I don't want to forget or there's things that I need to kind of walk away from and just kind of like let sit for a while. I don't know if I'm alone in that, but that's one of the reasons I journal. But I started doing a gratitude journal. And the ladies in my Bible study, we were talking about this. It is so good to be able to write down the things that you're grateful for because I think in life, we get in a place where we forget that no matter what circumstance you're going through, that there's something to be valued and be grateful for, be thankful for. And I really believe this is where this came out of. So I think we can put it on the screen. It says, I may not be able to explain the goodness of God enough to save someone, but I can exemplify that goodness in a way that leads them to who he is. See, we have a purpose in pouring. And it says in 2 Corinthians 4:7, but we have this treasure in jars of clay, similar to this, to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. So it kind of lets us off the hook. It is not our goodness that we're filled with that pours out, but it's His goodness. Now, I'm not saying we don't ever pour out who we are, because I think the front row can say I've poured out many a times my own self, and they're like, whoa, mama, that's a little much. But truthfully, it lets us know that it doesn't matter what we're going through, who we are, how we process life, that we have goodness of who Christ is in us that we get to pour. And that's important to sit on for a minute. Do we really value that we are created jars of clay that He has created? He has handcrafted? Not like this to where they have cracks in it. Maybe some cracks, but has been handcrafted by our Creator, our Christ Jesus. And we have value in what we pour. And so I really want to look at three different stories in the Bible that talk about different purposes for pouring. And again, this is something that God's been sharing in my heart. A lot of times when I get up here to speak, I'm like, what do I say? But usually I just have to go back and say, all right, what am I living? And that's what comes out. So come with me on this journey. I just want to share three things that I feel that we have purpose in with our pouring. And the first one's Luke chapter 7, verse 37. So you guys could turn to the Gospel of Luke. And this story is shared in other Gospels as well, but the one I take it from is in 7, verse 37. So let's read that together. Okay, it says, oh, I know what I forgot. These little guys. It's like, why does my page look different? And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil, or an alabaster box, and stood at His feet behind Him weeping. And she began to wash His feet with her tears and wipe them with her hair on her head. And she kissed His feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now when the Pharisees who had invited Him saw this, He spoke to Himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who in what manner this woman, this is who is touching Him, for she is a sinner. And then we skip down to verse 44. It says, then He, Jesus, turned to the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but my feet, I'm sorry, you gave me no kiss, but this woman has not kissed my feet since the moment I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. You see, this woman came and she was filled, but it was of herself and the iniquity that she carried. It wasn't the goodness of God, but she knew who Christ was. And she came to this place. And honestly, I really think that in this moment, it wasn't her first attempt to try and find Jesus. I have to believe that she had heard of this great teacher that changed and transformed lives. And she probably wasn't welcome in a lot of places because you can see she was defined by her sin. But found a place where she was uninvited, she was unwanted, unwelcomed. But she came to the feet of Jesus with a purpose, and it was to pour. She knew who was in the room because here's the thing, she was scolded by others, but in that moment, she was understood by her Savior. She knew who was in the room, but knowing Jesus gave her the confidence that she needed to pour out. I don't know if you're living in a place where you have things in your heart that you want to be able to pour out. Whatever that looks like, and you feel, wow, can I actually give that to Jesus? Is that something I can pour out? You know, for fear of, you know, once you're undone, will you ever be able to contain anything anymore? Sometimes there's almost a comfort in containing something, even if it isn't good. I think we've all been there. And this is the thing, she chose to pour out what she needed to be filled up by Him. She was seen by Jesus and valued above her costly perfume. And I think if we were to bring this into today's time, it would look a little bit like this. So I can see the Pharisees just, Boy, did you see what she did? We just got through going through our Dave Ramsey class. And one of the baby steps is to save for 3 to 6 months, right? And here she is pouring all that emergency fund on the feet of Jesus. Because see, that oil that she contained, it was a very expensive oil. It was worth many, many, I can't remember how much, but back then it would have been at least 3 to 6 months worth of savings in the emergency fund. And so I just thought that was kind of comical, because honestly, if in today's world, we would probably look and say, the value of what she's pouring out is so important. We could have used that and saved it for something else of worth and value. But we're missing the point. See, Jesus saw her above the value of the oil. Her life was valued in that moment. And I just thought that as a beautiful reminder that our brokenness has purpose. Our brokenness has purpose. And her story, you know, she walked into the house of these Pharisees. And back then, Pharisees were known for being the religious leaders of the day, having it all together, holiness on the outside, not so much of the attitude of the heart towards God on the inside. And so for people that really like to have it together and be known for who they are and go, you know, to be recorded and known for the holiness that they carried, this woman who had none of that looking on the outside had the value and the attitude of the heart on the inside that actually drove that story to where we're speaking of it to this day. And that to me shows that your brokenness has value and it will not be wasted. It is an untold story yet to be told. So I just want to challenge you with that. The second thing I see as a purpose in pouring is through service to others. You know, Pastor Stephanie does an incredible job in our Most Essentials. How many of you guys have been through Most Essentials in here? Yeah, that's a great, oh, we love it. We love it. But she gets to a part in the night where she talks about taking the corner of someone's mat. And I won't give the whole story away because it really, the way she tells it's incredible. But it really challenged me to how important service is to others, how important it is to pour out your service to one another. So all that to say, you need to go to Most Essentials if you haven't been before because you got to hear that story. It's really good. But I do want to look here in the Bible at the Good Samaritan, which is located just a few chapters in Luke past, in Luke 10. We look at over, skip over to Luke 10, just a few chapters, verses 30. Let me see here. And again, something I told the first service, I didn't really have in the notes, but I think it's really important to find ourselves in the Bible, because a lot of times, whether it's in our brokenness or our lack, or even just our own busyness in life and being filled up, but just not relating. If we can just find ourselves in the stories of this Bible, find that these people are not a lot different than who we are and what we're going through, and you will feel less lonely and less just desolate. You will find that, man, when I really want to relate, I can find my story in the Word of God. And so that really is something that going through these different stories, I know they're a little bit lengthy, but man, I have found some really neat, relatable just characteristics in the story. And I just want to encourage you guys to find the same on your own time. It says, then Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down to Jerusalem, to Jericho, and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a certain priest came down the road, and when he had saw him, he passed by the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So when he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you. So which of these three do you think was the neighbor to him who fell among the thieves? And he said, he who showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. So we have an example of how to serve. See, Jesus, he modeled compassion. He modeled compassion. If you read through the Gospels, you will find how Jesus, time after time, was moved with compassion. But that compassion moved to action. I don't think anybody in here can argue that there's things that we're passionate about that bring compassion to our hearts, and it stirs us. But until we move that to action, it just becomes awareness. And I think Jesus modeled it because in moving to compassion, he did the work. And it says, I put here in my notes, it says, who you contain is the compassion of Christ. But what pours out, and remember, it's his goodness is the action. So we have modeled to us so beautifully the action of being compassionate to others. And I have such an awesome Mother's Day story to share with you about this. I had a single mom call me this week, or actually she texted me. She said, hey, she goes, I was wondering if there was any needs in the church that I could contribute financially to. You know, I really want to chip in and help however I can. And I just thought that was so cool because she actually was someone that we knew had need previously around the holidays, that it was really neat we got to pour into her. But in this moment, she saw that not only the compassion of wanting to serve others, but to actually do something about it. So I was like, oh my gosh, there's actually another single mom in the church who is having transportation issues that could really use, you know, some financial relief. And so, you know, she texted me, how much does she need? I said, how much? And then after I sent it, I thought, ooh, it's a chunk of change. Like, it would have been enough for any of us to kind of take a step back and think, ooh, that's kind of costly. But before I could even, you know, write her back and say, hey, you know, don't worry, just whatever you give is fine. You know, we can be fine. We can all kind of help together. She had already texted me back and said, done. She goes, I already put it in push pay. I want to be anonymous, but just go ahead and give this to her. And I just thought, my goodness, here is a single mom with a single income helping out and seeing the need of another single mom and probably single income as well, and met that need through pouring. There is purpose in pouring. How much more can we do that has double income? And again, it's not always going to be about finances, you know, but in that moment, I just thought, what a beautiful way to exemplify Christ. One single mom has previously had a need, was able to give to another single mom in need in that moment. It's a beautiful Mother's Day story. But you might be saying to me, oh, you don't understand, Amy. I don't have it to give. I'm tapped out. Emotionally, I don't have what it takes to give. I get that. You might be saying, financially, there's no way I can hardly do what I can for my own family. Or if I can, it's just enough for my own family. I get that too. But the last thing that I want to talk about today is the purpose in pouring through obedience. Because here's the thing, I know that there's times that you're not going to be able to. And the Bible is full of places that is saying, you need to be still, or I need you to rest. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. But there's other places in the Bible, and we look at here, where it is really about obedience. We pour out of obedience. So this is my last story, but this is where I found myself living. So this is one that I really share from my heart today. Not that the other ones weren't from my heart, but you know what I'm saying. This is the one where I'm living. So it's over in 1 Kings. Did I lose my place? Oh, I lost my little marker. All right, so now I got to actually find Kings in the Bible. There we go. Okay. 1 Kings 17. If you turn over there, it's in the Old Testament. And we're looking at a time where there is a drought predicted by Elijah in the land. And I'm going to read through this story. It's a little lengthy, but I just love what's going on here. In verse 8, it says, then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. So she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make a small cake for me first and bring it to me. And afterwards, make some for yourself and for your son. So in this moment, this widow had a choice to make. You know, it wasn't uncommon for a prophet to speak something from the Lord and to ask the people to be obedient or to listen and heed the word of the Lord. So, you know, this widow had a choice to make. Can I trust? Can I trust? And this is off the notes. I did share it in the first service, but this is something that was really important that I want to share with you guys about trust. Have you ever had a hard time trusting someone? Yeah. It's hard to trust. And sometimes it's okay in those moments to be confused between the difference of trust and love. And God showed me something, because a few years back I was part of a friendship where it just wasn't healthy. And I really struggled with moving forward because I knew I'm supposed to love. But I didn't want to continue in case that trust was broken. And God gently reminded me, I never called you to trust people. You're supposed to trust me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. And through that, you are commanded to love. Man, that just freed me up, because I knew I wanted to move forward and friendship and have just a very organic relationship with boundaries, but to be able to love genuinely the way God had showed us and commanded us to love. And so I don't know who that's for this morning, but if you're struggling with trust and you feel like until you can move forward and trust for someone that, you know, you can't move forward unless you have that trust, that's not true. You trust God. You don't have to trust people. And through that, you'll find that as you trust him, he will show you the people you can trust. Okay? Because there's a lot of really cool, trustworthy people out there. But they don't just come because, you know, they're there. But you are commanded to love them. So anyway, that's off on a rabbit trail. But that was really powerful in a time where I really needed to hear that. So she had a choice to make, to obey or not. She chose to obey. She made that choice. In this case, we see that it wasn't about the value of the oil as much as it was the obedience to pour in spite of her lack. I don't think she was being irresponsible. I don't think in that moment if she would have said, no, I just don't have enough. I can't. I got to take care of my family. Because, I mean, if we didn't take care of our family first, if we took care of everybody else's needs, is that fair? I mean, those are questions we ask, right? I can't go over and above for others if I need to be responsible for who I am taking care of. I get that. But in this specific moment, because she chose to trust God through the prophet Elijah, this is what it said. So she went, it says in verse 15, so she went away and did according to the word of Elijah, and he and her household ate for many days. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. He redeemed her lack. God will redeem you. If he's calling you out of obedience to pour, I promise you he's going to give it back. Now, again, there's a difference between pouring when you're being obedient. I'm not asking you to pour if you feel guilt or condemnation. Don't even go there, okay? And if you're having trouble knowing the difference between the two, you know, pray about it. Don't act right away. Pray about it. God is such a good God. Again, it's the goodness of God that lives in us. He will show you. Okay? It's not like we're making these decisions, you know, good and or bad and worse. It's like good, better, best. You know, it's like, God, you're asking me to do something out of obedience. So I'm going to make that choice. I'm scared. This trusting thing's hard. But I see in this story, if you can give back to this woman to where she didn't run out, I can trust you that you will give back. He is a redeemer. I have lived that, guys. I'm not telling you this out of just a story in the Bible that existed many years ago. I'm saying I live this. He gives back. He will restore. He will redeem. I promise. So knowing that, it brings me to my last story, and then I'll close. And I did get permission to tell this story. Because, see, I give my kids a dollar every time I use them in a story, which doesn't sound like much when you're, like, this age. But for Maverick, oh, he is so excited about getting his dollar for this. Oh, my goodness. But a few years ago, I got to go to an incredible, it's called Orange Conference, and it's a children's ministry conference where they really pour into family life leadership and small group leaders and just really teach and train and just equip us through biblical example how we can create strategy to help you partner as we partner with you to help you with your families. And so it was just an incredible time where it was almost like drinking out of a fire hydrant. It was so much information. But again, it was such an incredible opportunity because we understand here at Momentum Church that you as parents, you have the single most influence in your child's life. Now, I think it's important to widen that circle of influence through, you know, the families that you connect with here at the church or outside the church. People, like we did a baby dedication the other day, or yesterday, actually. And just really bringing in who is that circle of influence that you want around your children. So important. So anyway, this leadership conference was just really pouring into us, you know, showing us how to lead and how to partner with families. It was just incredible. So I'm on this day two of this incredible conference, and I get a phone call. A little backstory. I'm sure none of you guys have had teenagers that can't wake up to an alarm. I'm probably alone in this, right? Okay, so I'm preaching to the choir. So our son Grant, and again, I got permission, right, to tell this story. So he was having trouble waking up to his alarm. And so we had said, look, Grant, you've got to start getting yourself up, all right? We can't be doing it for you. And this particular morning, Ross had to leave early for work, and there was no way he was going to get to school unless he rode the bus. So he's like, dude, you've got to get yourself up, get on that bus, and get to school. If you don't, you're walking to school, or you're going to pay for transportation to get to school. So that was the beforehand conversation. So I get a call from Grant. Mom, oh my gosh, I'm lost in the middle of the forest here. I don't know where I'm going. Don't know where I'm walking to. Dad just told me to go walk to school, and I don't know where I'm going. And again, I'm, you know, we're all laughing now, but in that moment, I'm just like, and let me tell you guys, the Lamaze training you took for labor and delivery, you will not use when you're in labor, but you will learn, you will use when you're raising teenagers. So I was using my Lamaze. Okay, so I know the backstory, I know what's going on, but in the moment, I can tell he's frustrated. I'm not home, I can't be doing anything about this. Then I get a call from Ross, and he's like, Amy, the kid is not lost in Cherokee County. He's between the Woodstock Trail and Woodstock High School. If he just keeps walking straight, he's gonna walk right into the parking lot of the school. So I could see him on the GPS. So in that moment, you know, it wasn't quite as comical. It was a very heavy feeling, but you know, we can look and laugh at it now. But it was very hard because here I am sitting at this convention. This children's ministry convention on how to pour into families and how to equip them and to create strategies, to love on them, to pour into them. And in that moment, I just felt like I couldn't even get myself together. I have World War III going on at home, and I'm here at this conference trying to learn how to pour, you know, into their families' lives, and I can't even pour into my own family's life. And that wasn't the only circumstance. I'm just using that circumstance kind of as a comical thing. You know, there's heavier circumstances that families go through or that you might be going through at your workplace. Relationships that you're dealing with that you're like, man, I don't have any more to pour. Or I can't pour where I want to pour. I was gently reminded that I'm not always going to be able to be in charge of where I pour, but that I'm willing to share this goodness in whatever God puts in front of me. Some of the best places and times of ministry have been unintentional. You see, ministry, and again, we're all ministers of the gospel. Ministry, in spite of our lack, pours out the goodness and power of who He is. We are simply the containers. So I don't know where you are in those three stories. I don't know if the purpose of you pouring needs to be out of brokenness, to really just pour out the brokenness, to be filled with the goodness of who He is. I don't know if it's where you're feeling a stirring to serve others and to really start locking arms and walk shoulder to shoulder with other people who need you to grab a corner of their mat. Or if you're simply in a place where you are just, you've calculated where you're at and you just don't have it. You genuinely don't have it. But it's out of obedience you feel that God is calling you to pour. Brokenness can seem costly to pour in front of others, but one word from Jesus heals all that is fragmented. Who doesn't want to witness firsthand a miracle of someone being made whole? We all can find ourselves in these stories, and we can all be a part of it. It takes all of us together pouring. I don't always enjoy the front side, okay? I said that yesterday at the baby D. I said, guys, I give you permission as families to not enjoy every stage of your child's life. Just being honest. But I do want to give you permission and challenge you to be present. To be present. And that's not just in children's lives. I mean collectively as a body of believers. We see each other weekly come together. But how do we pour into one another? Because here's the thing. It's great to come here to hear the word of God. But we should be doing that during the week. Okay? We're supposed to build each other up and encourage one another when we come together. And that takes pouring. Whether it's ourselves needing that, or giving it to others. So again, this is where I found myself when I was asked to speak. And I really hope this genuinely touches your heart. And I want us all to just bow in prayer as we pray this together. Jesus, there's purpose in all of us for what we pour. Help us to understand the value of brokenness, service, and obedience, because what we contain is your goodness. And Lord, as we do that, no matter the circumstances, allow us to exemplify you, Jesus, in how we pour out our lives to others. And to you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you. Love you guys.
Thank you so much, Miss Amy. I don't know if y'all know this, but my office is just down the way from Amy's, and I so often end up in her office on Monday mornings. I come early. I get up early to come steal her time because she pours so much into myself and so many other women at the church. So, Amy, thank you for pouring into us collectively this morning. Can y'all give her one more hand of appreciation? Thank you for being such a wonderful mother to this house. We love you very much. Guys, from Emma and I, we say happy Mother's Day to all of you. Whether you're here in person or you're with us online, if this is your first time with us, we want to take a special second to say welcome and thank you for joining us, letting us pour into you today. Do make sure that you fill out that connection card if this is your first time. If you're here in the building, we want to meet you, and we want to say thanks for being with us today. You can go out these double doors, down to the high top tables, like Pastor Ross said. We got a gift we want to give you, or if you're online, fill out that card and let us mail it to you this week, because again, we want you to just know how grateful we are to be able to worship with you, again, whether you're here or online. And if you are a mother in this place, I just want to take one more second to say happy Mother's Day. We hope you have a wonderful day. If you are a mother in here without a child or a child here without your mother. We just want you to know, man, our heart is with you today. We as a staff and as church family are praying with you and for you, just that the peace of God would be all over you today. So no matter where you go today, if you're going to lunch, if you're going to spend time with family, again, we are just praying for you and looking forward to what God is going to do in and through your life this week. And so once again, guys, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. And as always, we're with you on the journey. Oh, sorry, I forgot chocolate. Oh, let me not get you out of here without telling you about chocolate. Moms, there's chocolate as you leave. Take it and don't share it with anybody. Take it and eat it in front of your children as you drive home. Seriously, take that as you leave. And there's also a picture spot out in the lobby. So if you got up and dressed your kids to coordinate you for this one day a year, go and take your picture. Make them smile. So again, guys, enjoy that today. Again, we're with you on the journey.